Hello, Uthra. I welcome you to this program, Success Speaks, with a lot of congratulations to you and your family.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for having me here.
Yeah, this day, I know about your whole story of your success. I'm sure this is going to be very interesting for a lot of future aspirants to know about you, to know your success journey, because a person getting highest possible education, going to America, and then deciding, even after doing good package and job there, finally decided to come back to the country and serve in the country by joining civil services. So this is going to be very interesting for all the audience who are going to watch you, right? So once again, I welcome you to this program, Uthra. And a bit of your background will help the audience to understand where from you are and who are there in the family and what has been the journey from here to US and back to India, how it has all happened. Hmm?
Sure, I'm lucky to have this platform to share my story. So I'm basically from Kerala, where I did my Bachelor of Technology in Electrical Engineering. And after that, I decided to pursue Masters in the same from United States. So I joined Drexel University in Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. So after that, I did my research there and I joined a public utility company as a contractor, as an electrical engineer, actually.
Right. Hmm.
But it was while working there that was a turning point for me to realize that, you know, job satisfaction is something more than a fat paycheck, that, you know, you need, I needed more from my job than just being a technical person. So I decided to, after working for 2.5 years, I decided to stop doing that.
It's not a very easy decision. So when you're saying you are having a very, you can say, hefty package there, right? Naturally, working in the US as an engineer, that must have been a very interesting package. If you don't mind, I would like to ask you what package you were receiving there.
It is embarrassing for me to admit it, but it was more than 40 lakhs that I was getting there at that time.
So 40 lakhs in Indian currency, the worth
in
will
Indian currency. So in American currency, it would be around $72,000 per annum.
Yes, that's a very, very
starting salary.
Yeah, at the origin, something for India, that is a very good package, right? And then you worked as an engineer and platform there, right? But before we talk again about that, what made you back here, do you have some other members also in family who joined IAS, or you were someone first to come from your family to join civil services?
That's an interesting question. I am probably the first person in my close family to join government service. I do not have anyone in government service at all.
Right. What they do? What do your father, mom, what they do?
So my father is a businessman in Kerala. So we are into a little bit of food processing business.
Okay.
And my mom is a homemaker. And my sister and her husband are both dentist doctors. And I've been married for 7 years now. My husband is a software engineer in the United States. So he's currently working there. Then I have my in-laws. Yeah, we are a very close-knit family, one would say.
So this is very interesting for the audience to understand that you come from a business family of Kerala and you're all family members. They are highly placed. Your husband is also a software engineer. So naturally, definitely he might be earning very good package and you had a wonderful life in terms of luxury and comforts in the US, right? But then you decided to come back to India to study. So first question is, what cooperation you got from your husband in this regard? Because it was a decision that you would be back to a country and he's working there in the US, right?
Yes, sir. So the amount of the cooperation and the contribution that my husband has to my journey is immense. Like, he's the sole supporter for my journey. My whole family is extremely involved and they're supporting. But my husband was staying by himself when I came here for preparation. And currently I'm back and I might be doing training for 1.5 to 2 years. So he's going to stay back there. So he had supported me throughout this emotionally and in every other way he could. So yes, I've had immense support from my husband in this journey.
Uthra, since there is no one in the family in civil services, right? So naturally, it will be very interesting to know how this idea of going into civil services came. Did you have this something in mind when you were in India studying there? Or you came all after going to US? And who became instrumental in the whole decision?
So basically, it was my father who had planted this idea in my head when I was a kid that civil service is something you should do to see what your true potential is. How far can you go to challenge myself and not to get settled with, okay, gee, you have a job, you have a good paycheck. So he had always asked me to challenge myself, see if we can do this. But I was also young at that point, and I was carried away with the idea of going abroad. So I did not pay much attention to his idea at that time. So I went to US.
Okay.
But when I was there is when I realized, okay, what he said made sense. So I decided to pursue that old dream and come back.
So basically the seed for civil service was already sown by your dad. Your father had given that.
Yes.
And it is while working in the US that you, this idea came to US. Which part of US you were working in?
So I was in Philadelphia, which is a town in Pennsylvania. So that is on the East Coast, closer to New York.
Although we have discussed to some extent about that, but while you were working, you said about the 3 years you worked there, right? 3 years, yeah.
I worked there for almost 2.5 years. But
two and
I've
half.
Been in US for 9 years now.
So when you were working there, you said that you were getting good package, everything is that. But this idea which was being nurtured, right? So the main factors which were attracting you towards civil services to join, I would be interested to know on behalf of the audience from you, what were those dominating factors in your mind attracting towards India to come in the frame of governance in India that is called still pillar of Indian governance, civil services, right?
Yeah. So the first and foremost thing I realized while sitting in front of a computer and doing job is, that was not my cup of tea, that I wanted to do something where I can actually see the impact of my job, like the decisions I make or the decisions to not to do something. So I wanted to see the impact of that in people. And I believe for me, a technical job was not giving me that satisfaction. And again, I think this is something that most people who have gone abroad will relate to. You realize how important and how much of a role your country and your nation and that feeling plays in your life only when you go far away. When I was in US is when I realized I want to come back and I want to contribute to the society here. So these are the two main things that actually made me decide, okay, let me try civil services and see if I can come back.
So I'm sure you being a person with social orientation, because to contribute in the society, the lifestyle of US is completely different what we have in India. So you always had an empathy or understanding about your country that you could contribute by going in the among the common people, right? That's very
good. Yes, sir. That is one reason why I decided to do this.
Uttra, I think you took a decision to start appearing in the exam very late because I know about you with the discussion that you took 3 attempts. In the first and second attempt, you could not qualify. You did qualify pre also in the 2 attempts?
No, sir. I did not clear the prelims in the 2 attempts. I had grossly underestimated the exam in my first
year. You take all the consecutive attempts like 2017, 18, 19?
Yes, it was 17, 18 and I cleared the 2019 prelims.
So 2019 you cleared and you are already 32 now. That's why you became the, say, the last attempt also, right?
Yes.
And you have got 200 and... Which rank is this?
217.
217 rank, right?
Yes.
So definitely you're going to get a very good group of service, most likely either in IPS or you're going to Indian Revenue Service, I think this way, right?
Yes.
So now it will be very much of interest for the audience to know why you could not qualify in two attempts in the pre also, and what made you succeed in the third attempt to this extent?
So the first 2 attempts... My major reason was I had underestimated this exam, like grossly underestimated it. After being good in academics in college and also doing some getting my master's from US, I thought this is just another exam where I can study for 1 month and then I can do it. So I did not understand the requirements of the exam, or one would say I did not understand the nature of the beast. So I had completely underestimated the exam in that sense. So in my third attempt, I decided to sit down and watch a lot of videos of toppers. I analyzed the syllabus very clearly. I went to previous year question papers I talked to people who have already attempted. So I've decided to study the exam before I actually sat down to study the books. So I think that is the major deciding factor for me.
I understand, and the audience should understand also on your behalf, that in the two attempts, you jumped into the race without understanding the basic art of the game. What exactly is the need? But you realize finally that this cannot happen like that. Third attempt, you took it very seriously, did a lot of research. You listened to the toppers also. You did some of the people who were experienced and did it. So it means that, which is very, very pertinent, which is very important for the future aspirants to know, that don't jump into risk without understanding about the syllabus, requirement of the questions. And you must have some basic strategy developed while doing some basic groundwork and space work. That is very nice. So when you this understood this factor in the third attempt, again, how did you start? Where from you started studying? What basic books or starting books you again picked up? Would you like to share these all things?
Absolutely. So when I decided to do my third and last attempt right, the first thing I realized is after understanding the exam that I need to seek help. So I decided to get professional help from people who know what they're doing. Okay. And I joined an institute and I decided to get my basics right, as you've already mentioned. So I read the NCERT textbooks, which I believe is from where I could start completely. Then I had the standard book list. Lakshmikant was something that I had already started looking in my first two attempts. Then Spectrum for Modern India by Rajiv, Spectrum Modern India Rajiv Ahir book. Then I was also looking at the Atlas, and I was also trying to stay on top of current affairs. So I believe that is the basic process that everybody does. I would read Hindu religiously. No, even if I don't write note, I made sure that I read Hindu every day. And I was also following PRS India's website. Then I think Rajya Sabha TV was something that I would never miss. I would watch their news programs. I would watch their few programs like Big Picture and India's World Policy Watch. So I spent a lot of time initially to get my basics right. I know I was not keeping up with my competition, but I said, it is okay. Let me build my basic right and then build on top of it. So this is how I started my preparation.
See, you have really identified the best possible resources, started working on that. But here, the question again starts with your basic study of NCERT books. You said you laid your hands on the NCERT books, started going through that, right?
Sure.
So from which to which standard you studied and how you studied NCERT books? That will be an interesting thing to know for the audience.
When I started the preparation, I was, like I had said, I didn't know exactly what this was. So I started all the way from 8th standard. And I am not saying one should not do that. That is okay if you have enough time. But once I was pressed for time in my last attempt, I realized I kind of understood the 8th and 9th, but I was focused more on the topic and books that were pertinent to the syllabus. So I went from the syllabus to the books instead of reading all the books and then finding out what I needed from the syllabus. So if it was art and culture, I would go to the textbook. It doesn't matter if it is 8th or 12th, but is this topic relevant to the syllabus? So I kind of did a back study from the syllabus to the book instead of just sitting and reading the books. And my method was I would have a certain set of notes for prelims. So if there is something that I know I cannot remember, but it would be good for prelims, I would make notes for that. Then I would have a separate, I would have a separate note for mains, because I knew this is an analysis perspective I would get only from NCERT. So I would make a separate note for mains. So I was going kind of parallel, at least with the note making.
See, Uthra, you are using a very important concept about note making. Many of the students might be interested to know what kind of notes you are making and what is the art of making notes, especially for civil service examination. So how did you make the notes?
So note making, I think, is very key in the sense the process is going to be painful in the beginning, and it was painful for me also, because one page article, my note will be two pages. Mm-hmm. For some reason, I never understood how to make concise notes. But it was only through practice that one would get there. So if anybody is starting this process, my advice is initially it is painful, but you will eventually get there. And my idea was to pick each keyword from the syllabus. like if it is agriculture, if it is foreign policy, India, US, India, China. So I would have notes for each of those topics one by one. And anytime, every time I go over something that I think is good for mains or prelims, I would just keep adding to it. And I used to make handwritten notes, but you can easily do it on OneNote, Evernote, or whatever platform you choose to do it.
You are making later on the precise notes, which you could readily refer to and then revise later on, correct?
Absolutely. But
you were not knowing what to do, so you, in just in place of one page, you were making two-page notes. That is
yeah. But I eventually I learned to make it shorter. And another good resource I found was there is a not making method called Cornell's not making method, where they give you, when you listen to a lecture, how to make notes. So I would, towards the end of my preparation, to make it concise, I would follow that method.
You follow the app there, what you said?
So that is called Cornell, Cornell. So there is a university where they have a certain method of making notes.
That's interesting for the audience to know.
Yeah, so I started using their method of making notes towards then, so it will be
how
very
did you
concise.
Learn that method? Did you join any course or do you have something online to learn?
Absolutely not. It is just a template that you can get in any note making app or when you're in college. It's just something that it's a method of writing down your lecture notes. It's not even anything. It's just how you write. Why, what, when.
Okay. Yeah. That's it. So these are the basic parameters of following that, right?
Very exactly.
Good. See, a lot of things are there to remember. Most of the students have this fear. How to remember so many things? Because the process of the exam is quite long and then you're reading a lot of things. So how will remember? This is a very elementary question, but important question for the people who are going to start. How to remember a lot of things? What do you have to say about that?
I'll start by saying one thing, trust the process, because mostly all of us who have cleared this exam might be saying the same thing. You start by reading, making notes and revise. But this is something everybody says, which means there is no other way to do it. There is no shortcut to do it. So to remember, all that you have to do is make notes concise and revise, re-revise, and revise again, especially for prelims. Your struggle comes how to make that material where you're going to revise. You cannot revise a 5-page note for a single topic. So every time you revise, you're going to retain some amount of information at that point. Whatever you cannot retain, for me, it was numbers. I could not retain any number at any point. So after I had read anything, I would make a separate chart paper with the percentages, years, any numbers that I wanted, because that was my weakness. I would just go and read that once in a while, so I would retain it. So the mantra is to always revise, re-revise, and try to have it visually somewhere to look at it once in a while.
Very nice. Very nice. Putra, now my next question would be related to how to read newspaper and prepare for current affairs. Okay. Most of the time students have this issue. You might have also faced what is important in the newspaper, what is not in the newspaper, what and which newspaper to read, how to read. These are the basic bothering questions. What do you have to say about that?
So I'll start by answering which newspapers to read. I personally followed The Hindu, and I know a few of my colleagues who have followed Indian Express as well. So pick one or two newspapers, and if you're pressed for time, one is good. And how to read, again, I go back to the two clues that UPSC have given us to understand what they expect of you, which is the syllabus and the previous year question papers. So there is a lot of politics, there is sports, there are certain things that might be appealing to you, but you're here to write an exam and clear this one exam. So maybe you take that clue that UPSC has given. So I would go from syllabus and look at the newspaper. So after doing this a few times, every time I look at an article, I knew this is corresponding to this topic in the syllabus, so I need it. And you will understand that only with practice. Initially it took me 4 or 5 hours to finish a newspaper. But once you have done that process for some time, I will start understanding this is needed for this exam. I will take that note and I will add it to my notes, whether it is for prelims or for mains. So that is basically how I was doing my newspaper reading and note making from newspaper.
So basically, you studied through the syllabus, you understood, what topics are going to be important. And you also refer to the previous year question to understand. Is it correct?
Right. Yes. So then that you have to relate between the syllabus and the previous year question paper. The syllabus tells you what they're going to ask. And previous year question paper is telling you how they're going to ask that topic. So you see secularism, but how is secularism going to be a question? We can understand only from the previous year question paper.
How much time you used to give to newspaper?
Initially, it took me a lot of time, but towards the end, I would spend mostly 2 hours, 2.5 hours reading Hindu newspaper.
And were you reading some specific newspaper?
No, sir. I was reading Hindu, and towards mains preparation and interview, I referred to Indian Express as well.
Okay, these two papers, and then
yes. You
focused on all these things there, right?
Okay, and also I used to do, there is something called monthly policy review that PRS India gives out, which is very useful, I think. So I used to follow that. And sometimes there are Telegram channels from the institute that I joined, and many premier institutes have it, where they will send you some good articles from all across the internet. So you don't spend a lot of time looking for these things. So if you're professional help, you do also get compilation from Premier Institute.
Yes. But so Uthra, one big question with the student is, rather it's a problem, there is a lot of information overload coming from a lot of sources there. So identifying relevant source and sticking to a few of them is really a big challenge. Did you also face such problem in the beginning and later on you focused on a few?
Yes, sir, absolutely. Because I have ended up with at least 4 editions of Lakshmikant because I thought I need to buy the next one to stay updated. Mm-hmm. But I'm telling from my experience, it's a big mistake. There are 2 things you need to think about when you're looking at the material or the resources required. So firstly, you don't have a lot of time. So you have to consolidate your material. If you don't consolidate, you cannot revise. So every time you write something, consolidate, put everything together. So material consolidation is very key. Second thing is limit your resources. Take some time, spend 1 or 2 weeks to understand where you're going to study each keyword in the syllabus from. It will take time, but once you have decided, do not waver. If you do, you're going to go far and wide.
Right.
So stick to the resources that you have chosen and consolidate your resources for a revision. This is what I did.
This is very, very important in place of reading through one resources 3-4 times. If you're going for different resources one time, half-heartedly, that will not help. So it is better.
It will also make you nervous because you cannot finish the one that you started and now you have another new book that you need to read. So it will actually affect your mental stability and emotional stability.
The basic idea is not to finish books, but to finish the syllabus. Relevantly,
yes.
Right? That is very
important.
Now, the next important thing goes about time management, how much to spend time and how to manage your time, right? Many of the starters in this race, they always have a fear or say a lot of doubts that they would have to give up everything in the world and 17 hours, 15 hours they have to dedicate. That will be, there is no any personal life like that. Do you think it is a correct statement?
I personally, I do not think that is right because after you study the exam, what I usually say is then you have to study yourself.
Right.
The only person who can tell you how to manage your time is you. So for some people, if they sit for 4 hours, they have the concentration of 8 hours. And for someone like me, who actually have to sit 17 or 12, 15 hours a day, but my productivity might be different. So it is up to you to personally decide how much time you can spend a day. But the key word is productivity. how with being productive. You can sit in front of a book.
What were your average working hours for this exam?
Since this was my last attempt, I really had to push myself to clear prelims and mains. So I did spend almost 12 to 15 hours a day if I'm not attending classes.
Right.
I know people who have cleared this exam who are working professionals, mothers, full-time mothers. So it is all about the productivity. It is not about the number of hours that you put in.
Okay. How much time concentrated you can remain and how much productive you are, that is very important.
Yeah. Yes.
What was your normal schedule and the routine? Right from sleep to exercise or study, did you have some plan, structured plan or not?
With respect to, like, I didn't have it broken down to, I'll wake up at this time, I'll do this. But I would always have a schedule on how much to finish. So I was mostly focused on finishing topics rather than I'll study for 2 hours, 3 hours. So I would have a set timetable for I'll finish this by this many days. So I used to stick to that. And based on my mood and my sleep, or whatever I felt like sleeping. And as I have mentioned, my husband was in US while I was preparing. So there is a time zone difference. So I had to adjust to talk to him, like their morning is our late night. So I would just focus on the fact that I will study this much by the end of this week. Not like I'll spend so many hours.
Were you compromising your sleep also or having 6 to 7 hours sleep at least?
I would compromise on my sleep for 2 days and then I'll realize on my third day that was a mistake. Then I have forgotten everything that I studied in the first 2 days. So to be consistent and to actually, I will borrow the words of another topper. This is not like a sprint. This is a marathon. So you have to have a strategy which is consistent for you.
Consistency, that is right.
Yeah. So if you sprint for 2 days and you're burned out and then you're exhausted third day, you're wasting a day. So do not compromise on your physical health.
A very powerful word. Consistency is very, very, very important in this examination, right? That is very
excellent. That is correct.
Uthra, basically, the students always find problem of how to remain motivated. You know, it's a long journey. You also had 3 years journey. You left your very lucrative job there in the US, came here. So definitely sometimes especially when you miss twice, some thoughts might have come, whether you did it right thing by quitting the job and coming to India, whether you would be able to qualify, what will happen. Did you also pass through such kind of phases?
I think I've been fortunate enough to not dwell on those thoughts because my support system was really good. So every time I would ask that question, my family, my husband would say, it doesn't matter, you still have one more attempt. So if you don't clear it, you can always come back. So I was lucky enough to have that system.
Right.
And my motivation or my advice is find something within yourself to motivate you. If you're looking for something external, like I want to be famous or I want status, see, all those things will go after some time. So for me, it was, I want to prove to myself that I can do this. This is a very tough exam. It requires a lot of dedication. And every other exam is 1 month preparation. This is something that is a cycle of 1 to 1.5 years. So I wanted to prove to myself that I can do it. So my motivation was from inside. And the thought that I can do something and be part of something that is bigger than myself.
Right.
So it's all inside me that was motivating me. And I think that is the kind of motivation that sticks with you.
Right. That's why you have some driving force that I have nothing to lose. I have to gain something. If I get it here, I have accomplished my mission. Right. That is very, very important. Right.
Yes.
Now, how well begun is half done? You know, this is all saying is there. Mm-hmm. You might have seen in initial 2 attempts there. Right. So you definitely made the integrated preparation for pre and mains both, right? But to be sure to qualify in pre is also very, very important, because if you don't qualify, then you don't get a chance to go in the mains also there.
Mm-hmm.
We are right now very close to the civil service examination 2020 pre, forthcoming on 4th of October, right? So here, especially for the students who are stuck in the pre, especially like you who could not make earlier or who want to make a sure sort of that. What kind of basic tips you would like to share with the people which will help them to make some kind of surety to the coin winery?
We have the basic things that you have to do is first identify whether your resources are right. Identify whether you're actually, so for me, the major thing was, are you practicing enough? Are you actually simulating the feeling that you get inside the exam hall enough? So that is something that I think makes a big difference from performing really good in all the mock tests, studying all the material, but on the day of the exam, you're not able to actually get to the same point. So right. Simulate that feeling as much as you can, practice as many mock tests as you can. So these are two things that I did differently to clear my prelims. One more thing I would like to add is, if you're consistently finding it difficult in your prelims and you're not, talk to someone about why you picked the wrong answer when you picked one. Okay. So instead of just learning that right answer, see, we all know prelims, anybody who has prepared well can only do 40 answers, 100% right. The rest is, there is elimination technique, guessing game. To actually get that, what I did is I was preparing with a friend. So we would discuss why someone chose that wrong answer. Talking aloud about your thought process helps you identify what is that consistently wrong thing that you're doing. Why is your brain going in that wrong direction? So I think that is a tip that I took from a few mentors that I met on the way, and I practiced it, which made a big difference to me.
There are certain mistakes which are committed by the students in examination hall also. Right.
Yeah.
Right, from managing their alertness level or managing their own stress and anxiety, right?
Yes.
To the performance in the exams and all. So what would tips you would like to give for the students who go under such kind of stress and anxiety? Which how they can overcome it and the performance can be better there in the exam?
I understand this is a very tough exam. And a lot of us have been preparing for this a long time. But if you can, at least for that 1 hour before the exam and 1 hour after the exam, just think of, this is just another exam. This is not your life or death situation. If you don't clear this, you have some other job. This is a very good job, but this is not the end of life. Right. So get into that mindset. I have nothing to lose. This is an exam. I still have my life. So if you can be in that mindset throughout the exam, I think that is what I did. I just thought, this is just another exam. I don't have to be afraid of that. So that is a mindset which you can get through mindful meditation, practice some yoga, and have good people and peers to talk to. But get into that mindset. Do not be afraid of the exam. I think that really helps in that 2 hours that you're actually in the exam.
See, it is always powerfully said that fear of failure becomes the real reason of failure. Absolutely. So if you are always being dominated by fear that I'll lose it, or emotionally you are held up, so natural performance will go. So excellent. What you're saying is that you should go with stress-free mind and don't think it's the end of your life. This is a big platform. It will teach you a lot. If you succeed, it is going to, you get it there. Even if you are missing something, you are going to get something better in life. So if you go with this idea, you'll do better. Very nice. That's very well said.
Hi, my name is Ranjita Sharma. I've secured rank 130 this year in the Civil Services Exam 2018, and I'm getting into the Indian Police Services with this rank. Here I'd like to mention that I appeared for a mock interview at Chanakya right before my final interview, and the atmosphere provided here at the mock was quite similar to my actual interview. And it helped me remain calm. The feedback provided at the interview was really, really helpful, because it not only helped me understand the areas that I needed to work upon, but at the same time, the positive feedback helped me stay motivated in the run-up to the interview, because the time is very, very crucial. So I'd like to thank Chanakya IAS for all the help offered. Thank you so much.
Now, coming to the main part of the examination, that is the mains, right? There are a lot of papers, four general studies paper, one essay paper, right? And then two options, one optional subject and two of papers there also. Variety of things are there. So when it is a question of shifting the mind from pre to mains, of course, you have to make integrated preparation. But when you shift your mind from pre to mains, what should be the fundamental approach for the mains to handle?
So the way I approached it is, I actually thought from the jobs. I kind of did a reverse engineering. The administrative job, so you need to have really good knowledge. Like, you have to have pinpoint facts to make your argument. But then as an administrator, you have to move from use that pinpoint facts that you learned in prelims. And as an administrator, you need to use that in policy making to analyze a topic. So I wouldn't consider both as two different things. So in mains, you're analyzing a factor with the help of facts that you have learned in prelims. So something that you learned in prelims becomes an example in your mains.
You're right. Mm-hmm.
So always try to think of that. Whenever you see a topic or you're coming across an article, think which part of the syllabus it applies to. And as a policymaker, as an administrator, how can I analyze this topic? And then what example can I give it in that topic, which becomes your answer for prelims? So I think that is one way to actually look at it. And when it comes to interview, how can I, as an administrator, communicate all these things to the third person? So just think of the job you are doing and do reverse engineering to understand the requirement of the exam.
So when you write answer, of course, this is all knowledge-based things there in like history, geography, polity, economy, thing you're reading there. But do you think, as compared to university exam, there is a different approach for appearing in this main examination? There is a limited standard. They had already fixed the 10+2 standard for general studies. Optional subjects will be of graduation level. So with your experience, what suggestion would you like to give to the students who are not able to make a difference between university exam and this exam?
My first thing is, what I have done in my last two attempts, do not underestimate this exam. If you are a serious candidate and you really want to clear this exam, you have to take it actually with a pinch of salt. This is a very serious competitive exam. So in college, you're not competing. You're just getting a percentage. You're not competing with anybody else. And the syllabus is clearly defined for you. The books are clearly given to you. But here, you are aspiring for a top administrative post. So the exam will definitely be like that. Your competitors are actually spending a lot of time. They've started preparing from very young age. So do not underestimate the exam. Do not underestimate your competition. And this is a cycle. In college and school, you'll have one exam, a semester exam or a mid-break exam. But here, the cycle is 3 for almost 1.5 years. So you have to be consistent. You cannot just study for 1 month. So do understand the exam and really get the fact that this takes a lot of consistent hard work for almost 8 to 9 months or even 1 year. So I think that is a big difference.
Okay, that's very, and the kind of questions which are being asked to you, they are checking more of your administrative ability than your scholarly and research ability.
Yes, sir, that is a good point that I left out actually. So this is actually analyzing you as a person who is aware of what is going on around you. In school or college, you can just study the book and get away with it. But you are, as a person, you are expected to know what is going on around you. And you have less than 7 minutes to write an answer. So you can pretend to be someone you are not. You don't have the time to pretend to be someone else. So whatever you have ingrained in you actually shows in the paper. So during your preparation, try to be that person who's a good administrator.
That is perfect. Very well said. Very well said. What optional subject you had, Uthra?
I did political science and international relations.
This is very interesting to know for the audience again. You are engineer with electricals, right?
Sir.
And you chose to take political science. So how to select an option is again a very important thing. Could you share your experience? How did you select your optional and especially landed to take political science as your subject?
So for me, I was very keenly interested in international relations as a person. Like, even before I started preparation, I just liked how the whole entire world system worked. I was always amazed by it. So international relations was something I was really interested in. So naturally, when I started preparing for the exam, I went and looked at the syllabus for international PSIR. And I just realized that there is a lot of overlap between political science, PSIR optional, and also with the GS preparation. So that was one major thing for me, especially because I was studying optional in my last attempt. The first two attempts, I had not even studied for mains or for my optional. So I had to find something that had an overlap. And also it really helped me with other GS papers like GS1, GS2, and ethics. It really gave me an edge. And essay writing, you are learning all these different views. So it actually helps you with essay writing. And also with interview, you are learning a lot about, I did have a lot of, I mean, not a lot, but I did have few IR questions also in my interview. So I think that was another thing that one can look into. But the first and foremost thing is your interest.
Yes.
I mean, yeah, PSR is not the only optional toppers.
I was waiting for the same because I also, most of the toppers I've discussed with, and even I always suggest students, unless you have interest in the subject, you will not be able to take it forward. That is
right. Yes. That is very key that you have an interest to study the subject. And also, third thing I think is, do you have enough support system? Like, is there a mentor available? Is the books available? Are you able to actually talk to someone about your doubts? So I think these are the three things. I don't believe that there is a scoring optional or anything. It's just primarily your interest and how you are able to manage it with GS preparation and how you can actually get help in actually preparing for it.
Very nice. So now a few tips for those who want to take political science as optional subject, how they should begin and they can do good in the subject. Just try to give a few words for that.
For everything, the first and foremost thing I say is look at the syllabus. And I used to make one by like keyword, each keyword from the syllabus, I would have notes. And I, as I had already mentioned, I decided these are the three resources I'm going to use. I will not go into anything else. And so I took the keywords from the syllabus. I made comprehensive notes using my resources and I stuck completely to it. I was also lucky enough to have mentors who pinpointed to me, these are the clear topics. So I would suggest seek help. Do not mean if you're a person who can do it on your own, well and good, no problem. But I needed help. So I sought professional help from people who knew what they were doing.
Well,
so that is another thing that would really shorten your time and improve your productivity. Another thing is answer writing when it comes to political science and international relations.
To do a lot of practice for writing, right?
Yes. And also understand the difference between GS answer writing and your optional answer writing. That is very key, in, especially for PSC.
This will be a very interesting topic to understand because how to write in GS and how to write in optional. So please elaborate that.
So I always do the reverse engineering from the job profile to the exam. So in your GS, they're trying to see as a generalist administrator how you're going to do it. So you're expected to know the social, political, economic, international, all those impacts of this topic that is given in front of you. But then when you actually think about the job, you will be posted in one, like you could be a secretary for a certain economics, or you could be an economist, or you would be in ground level work. So optional actually checks, are you able to study one topic in depth in certain time and express that? Not just be a generalist, but can you also be a specialist? So you have to understand that is the skill that they're looking for between GS and PSIR. So take that one idea that you have and beautifully express it. That is what I think I did in political science and international.
That's right. Now, Uthra, we'll talk about personality test. You have gone once in personality test, right? Interview, civil services
yes,
interview.
Sir.
That's always a dream for students that one day I'll go to the Dhaulpur house and appear in the exam, right?
Yes,
did you have an interview? Did you have interview pre-corona or post-corona situation?
Pre-corona, I was on the second day of the interview.
Okay, so you had quite in the beginning itself.
Yes.
Now, from your experience, what do you think the selectors want to see you in personality test?
What I understood is, do you have presence of mind? In my experience, it's all about presence of mind. So again, I go back to the same thing. You are in a job, you are an IPS officer, you immediately have a law and order problem. You need to have the presence of mind to deal with any situation that is put in front of you.
Perfect.
So I think that is, and with their years of experience, they can understand if you have presence of mind. So even if you say blunder, even if you don't know the answer, I think it's just, are you present there? Are you listening properly? And are you actually communicating to, see, you always say answer to the question, do not digress, which actually shows you have presence of mind. So I believe what they're looking for really is, are you actually present there with your full attention and all your faculties right there?
Okay, that's, and you definitely have a wide range of questions there. So would you like to share some of your experiences that when you entered in the board, who was your chairman?
It was Bhonsle, sir.
Okay. So overall, how it all began and the progress happened there in the interview and some of the important questions which you faced, would you like to share that?
So, sure. So mine was in the forenoon session and I was the last one to go. And I was kind of a little bit nervous, but then again, I went back to my common thing, like, okay, this is just another interview. This is not end of the world. So I was able to stay calm throughout the interview. So sir asked me, just introduced me a little bit and moved on to the first members. The interesting thing was, while the first member was asking question, he stood up and went to the bathroom. Okay. And he was not present until the third member or fourth member started asking. So I was kind of nervous. Did I do it that bad or that terrible that he didn't want to listen to me?
Okay.
And while I'm talking to one member, all the other members are talking, like giving, like asking for tea, asking for hot water. So there was a lot of talking between them while I'm talking to a single member. So
okay.
I think, I don't know if it's intentional, but I was still able to continue that single conversation without getting distracted with all these things around.
You're right.
And
this is also a method to check whether you can focus even there are some distractions or not. With the person you're talking, are you able to concentrate there when there are some these kind of normal disturbances going around you?
Yes. Cool. So I kept telling myself, but do not be distracted. Just stay focused. So I think that is why I got the feedback that they're looking to see if you have presence of mind right there.
That is, presence of mind in any case is always the most important factor to go.
Yes.
Any situation, any question where you found you were held up and you found difficult to come out?
I had quite a few questions that I could not answer. And when I was doing mock, I was told, if you don't know the answer, just say, I don't know. So I decided to say, I don't know.
You managed the same thing there. That is very well.
But they did not accept that as the answer. So mostly I was like, okay, so you don't know. Let us find out if we can help you to get to that answer. So he would make me say things, make me say blunders. And at the end, he would tell me the answer. So he will not take, I don't know, for an answer for me. So I think they were testing if I actually break down at some point. I think that is what they were.
They try to check your level of strength, how long you can continue, whether you go in the bluffing side or you still maintain your poise in all the odd situation also.
Right.
Very well said. Now, Uthra, since you have already got selected for civil services, right? And you're going to definitely get one of the topmost services in center government, right?
Yes, sir.
How do you see your career ahead for another 30 years or 35 years ahead?
I don't know exactly the way it is going to go, but like I said, wherever I go, and whatever I do, I just hope I just give it my best. Like I prepared for this exam and my pelvic presence of mine. And also it is very humbling and honoring to be part of something so big. Like to be part of this nation building, yes, is so humbling. So I just hope I do my best and I do not let down the people
best
who have trusted me.
Best for the country. That's very, very powerful. So Uthra, I wish you all the best and great career ahead in civil services. And I appreciate your decision now, coming back to the country by quitting even the lucrative job of US. And there's need of people like you to really serve this country, right? Who are really willing to serve, not just getting carried away by, you can say, pomp and show of the Western world, okay? So wish you all the best and God bless you with a lot of success in your career, okay?
Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to share my story to a lot of people and aspirants. And thank you so much.
I also enjoyed talking a lot with you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Don't forget to like, share and subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon to never miss an update.